So my name is Gaurav Agarwal. I work as a software engineer with data platforms team at AOL. I'm also part of Code and Community program, which encourages this public speaking and open source contribution. So our team basically deals with the web traffic data from a third party called Omniture. We receive hourly logs for all our web properties, and our team basically provides the data in summary formats or raw data to the business for their analysis. So this is the simple architecture we had around a year back, where source system, either external or internal, used to push all the data into in-house Hadoop cluster, where all the ETL operations were done, and the data was then loaded to database for further reporting and analysis. Users were primarily hitting the database, and Hadoop cluster was mostly used only for ETL purpose. And it created a lot of challenges to us. So the first thing was it was a fixed cost problem. So we enter into a multi-year contract with the hardware company, and you have to pay the same cost for that duration. The storage and compute were tightly coupled. What I mean by that, we had X number of nodes with X petabytes of storage, and if we had to increase storage, you have to add more nodes, or if you want to add more compute, the storage will increase. So we could not increase or decrease either of them without impacting the compute or storage. The next problem was it was always on. Since we dealt with the batch data, there are times during the day when we don't have data to process, but the cluster was up and running, so it requires maintenance and obviously some cost associated. So that cluster was not was always static. If we had more workloads or if we did not have anything, there were fixed number of nodes. It did not adjust, or it was not elastic according to the demand we needed. There was no BCDR. It was a single point of failure. So in case there are some disasters, that was the only cluster we had. And if we had to create a BCDR solution, that would have been twice the cost of what we had. Based on the business requirements, we had like thousands of jobs which are maintained by operations. So it used to create a nightmare to keep a track of all the dependencies and things like that. So there were so many jobs running in production, and it required a lot of legacy knowledge as well. So that was one of the major challenges as a developer. Whenever there used to be upgrades or any patches done to the production cluster, it used to create an outages. So SLA was impacted, and also for the upgrades, dev team or QA team had to do a lot of black box testing to make sure anything that is existing in production does not break. So it used to result in slow deployment cycles, ultimately affecting the business projects. So what we did was we decided to migrate to AWS. We created a very simple architecture where the source teams will push data to S3. There is an EMR which will read data from S3, do all the ETL operations, push data back to S3. And we did not touch the right side of the architecture, where database is still used by users and analysts to query the data or create their reports. So to push to load the data to database, we created a jump post which extracts data from S3 and loads it to the database. So the flow is data goes to S3, EMR reads data from S3, does the ETL, data goes back to S3, it's downloaded on the data center and loaded to database. So what we did not do was we did not forklift the same Hadoop cluster we had, because we would have run into some same challenges with some operational efficiencies. So we thought, instead of creating a persistent cluster on AWS, let's try out the transient model. So this is the case when we don't have anything to process. So there is no cluster running when there is no data to process. And if you have multiple workloads to process, then we create multiple EMRs in parallel, where each cluster is independent of the other, and it's processing only the data which is required by that particular data set. So the good thing is each cluster can process data of different complexity, and each cluster can be of different size, maybe of different instance type, because it's not dependent on other cluster at all. All these clusters come up in parallel according to the demand, do the ETL jobs, write the data back to S3, and all the cluster goes away. So some of the unique features that we could achieve because of that was, first of all, we decoupled the storage and compute. S3 is primarily used for storage. All the data that is required for either database load or for analysis is stored on S3, and EMR is used only for the compute operation. There is no persistent infrastructure. All the clusters are transient. They do their job, they do their ETL operations, and the cluster goes away. We achieved massive parallelism, so we have had 700 to 800 clusters running in parallel, and none of the clusters are talking to each other, so there is no constraint of resources or anything like that. Each of those clusters can be of different variety according to the data they are processing. So an hourly cluster which is processing data for a smaller country can be of 2 nodes versus a big cluster for USA which is processing data for a month can have 500 nodes. So we have a variety of clusters according to the data that is processed within the cluster. So for optimizing the cost, what we did is instead of making use of on-demand, we made use of spot instances. So if you have worked with AWS, there is a spot concept where you actually bid for the EC2 instance, which is 70 to 80% cheaper than what is usually the on-demand. It is cheaper than the reserved instances as well. So one of the reasons we could make use of spot instances was we deal with the batch data, and with spot instances, there is a caveat that there is a provisioning time involved. Like, you have to bid for that instance, and if that particular bid is met, basically that instance is allocated to you. So that's how we made our infrastructure cost effective. Then what we did was we made the whole architecture loosely coupled. What I mean by that is we tried to design our EMRs in such a way we are not doing a lot of operations within a single cluster. We tried to logically break them into separate clusters so that right from the start of data ingestion till the final summary, you have created separate stages. So if you have issues with particular stage, the whole pipeline is not broken. Also, on the data center side where we have to extract and load, instead of extracting and loading at the same job or at the same time, we try to make sure those are not dependent. So if you have issues or outages with the database, the extract operations are running and the loads can catch up whenever the issues are resolved or vice versa. So we try to make sure the things are less dependent on each other. If you have third-party APIs or if you have third-party dimensions, then those are also staged. Those are also staged independently so that none of the processes are impacted by outages of other or any other hardware issues. One of the things that we also did was we did not stick with a single AZ or region. If you see the usage of AWS, North Virginia is the biggest region, and that's the first region we also started with. And we suddenly realized that we are using a single region a lot, and within that region, we were also using a single AZ a lot. So that was not a good idea, because anytime there were outages or anything, we would have been into the same situation of BCDR. So what we thought, let's make ourselves configurable to run all our clusters in any of the region so that we are not tightly stuck with a single region or single AG. So these are the things that we took care while we moved to AWS. Few of the benefits that we achieved because of this is the migration itself resulted in 50% plus cost savings for us. The major reason for that was spot instances, obviously. So that was a big win. The next thing is data restatements. So what happens at AOL is sometimes when there are brands shifted across different departments, sections, or BUs, business usually put a request to our team to restate the data going back 2 years. So for their financial projections and realigning the goals. So this particular use case with the Hadoop cluster which we had in-house used to take close to 2 months, because that cluster was doing the regular job of production processes, and this was the additional overhead. So it used to take around 2 months to do this particular use case, and we usually get this use case once a quarter or whenever there are shuffles. But with AWS, since we could make use of parallelism, we finished that use case within hours. Because if we had to restate data for 2 years, and if monthly data has to be restated, we spun up 24 independent clusters, and none of the production processes were impacted. So that was a major, major win for our team, not in terms of cost, but as a business, so that we can reach out to business and say, we don't have hardware constraints anymore. We can do more things for the team. So that was a major win. And since so many jobs or data is not processed for a longer time, it used to make operations life easy as well, because the clusters are not impacting other production processes, so other jobs did not fail. So it helped operations team as well. And dev QA cycle did not have to put a lot of efforts in testing whether if I use Spark or Presto, if I upgrade to the latest version of Hive, will it break the existing stuff, because none of the projects were running in the same cluster. It took care of BCDR because the clusters can run in any region. And at a particular given time, if you don't have anything, there is no infrastructure to manage. And EMR is a fully managed service by AWS, so if you have any hardware issues or anything, basically, if you have enterprise support, they'll help you with that. So it itself created a lot of challenges as well. So when we deployed our full base to production, we reached the stage where we have close to 700 clusters running every day. So the first challenge it created was, how do we create a pipeline? Because right from the data ingestion to the final summary creation for the business, we have so many stages. So how do we make sure dependencies, like how do we make sure a daily job kicks off only after all 24-hour clusters are finished? On top of that, we have data for 20 countries, so things like that. So how do we orchestrate the whole process pipeline? That was the first challenge. Just making use of spot instances is not good enough. So how do we make sure that we further optimize the cost? Since we have all our data on S3, what options could we explore to use S3 or as our data query instead of loading it to database again? That is a redundant thing. And how do we monitor these many clusters? So these were the few challenges which we worked on mostly this year. I'll walk through all of this. So what we did with the pipeline was, AWS has a service called Lambda, which works based on event. So imagine a file, a data set lands on S3. So a file gets dropped to S3, that data set A has to run. So as soon as that file is dropped, a Lambda function gets triggered off, which is basically a Python utility. It identifies what data set I need to run. It kicks off an EMR for that particular data set. And if there are downstream, then it drops another file to S3, which in turn kicks off the Lambda. And this cycle repeats until you finish, until you reach the final summary creation. So before this architecture, we used to have thousands of AutoSys jobs to create summary for each country and for each data set. So EMR has helped us reduce the SLA significantly, because AutoSys job used to be a scheduled job, so it used to run at a particular time on a particular day, versus Lambda is event-based. As soon as upstream EMR is done, it kicks off the downstream EMR, and the response time is within milliseconds. One of the things that we did was, instead of creating separate Lambda for each data sets or each process, we created generic one. So there is a standard now we are following that each data set has to be of this format. So a single Lambda code has replaced over 2,000 AutoSys jobs for us, which is working pretty well, because you have improved the SLA and there are less operational overhead jobs to maintain. You don't need to worry about auto-scaling, because even if you have thousands of files being dropped to S3, Lambda scales automatically. There is no limit. You can even try with hundreds and thousands of EMR at the same time. Cost-wise, we used to pay thousands of dollars for AutoSys. EMR, you get 1 million requests free per year, and after that, the next million is 20 cents. I'm sure we are not going to have a million EMRs at least within a year. So it's almost free and the best option available. In case you really need to schedule something, there are cron options as well. So we solved our problem of creating the pipeline using Lambda. Now, cost optimization. So I talked that we reached a stage where we have around 700 production clusters running. And those clusters translates to thousands of spot instances. There are multiple instance types, and each cluster has different data volume. There is an hourly cluster, there is a weekly, there is a daily, there is a monthly cluster, depending on the day of the month. And the code complexity is also different. Just creating raw data from the source versus creating a complex business summary requires different code complexity. So we knew that these are the few things where we can really work on, which can save a lot of cost for us. So what we did was, first thing we did, we made our infrastructure set up to run on all the regions. So currently we have set up to run in all US regions across, and as well as international. We cannot use GovCloud in China, so we are not set up there. Then we have set up limit within a region for all AZs. So imagine a region is like a bigger area. Within each region, AWS has multiple data centers. Each data center is like an AZ. So in US East, like in Northern Virginia, you have 5 AZs. So you can make use of their 5 data centers. So we defined that within a data center, we'll have like X amount of instances at max. Then on top of EC2 price, there is an EMR convenience fee that is charged, but it is a constant across the globe, so you don't need to worry about it. So how we optimize the cost is, for a particular data set, let's consider data set A. During our dev and QA, we know how complex the code is or how much memory or compute we need for that particular process. So we define what are the instance types that can support this particular project. Because a tiny project can survive with M1 medium instance, but a larger or more complex one might need more compute or more memory. So for each data set, we define what are the instance types that it can run on. So we pick a particular instance type, and the first thing we do is we create the list of spot price across all AZs, across all regions, that is sorted by their pricing. So one thing that we make sure is sometimes the spot price can be higher than on-demand, and AWS has a valid explanation for it. So we put a range as well, that we don't want to bid beyond 5 cents for M3X large. So like, there is a higher range for each instance type, which is a global setting. So once we have the list for that instance type with the pricing across all AZs, we pick one AZ from the list one by one. Then we check how many spot instances we already have active or running in that particular AZ. So if there are other EMRs running, suppose there are 10 EMRs already running in US East 1A, which accounts to 800 EC2, then the A becomes 800. That these are the already open active instances in that AZ. On the right-hand side, once you have picked a particular instance type, you need to know that how many number of cores do you need for that particular instance type. So number of cores are decided based on data volume of the data it has to process and the code complexity. So what I mean by that is, suppose you choose M3 X large or X large series, and you have to process 100 gigs of data. You might need 200 nodes. But with M3 4X large or M3 2X large, you can need 150 or 100 nodes. So depend. As you go up in your configuration for instance type, you'll need lesser number of cores. So the number of cores is a combination of instance type plus data volume it has to process, and also code complexity. One thing that you have to also consider is Amazon bills you per hour. I think Google Cloud bills you after 10 minutes per minute. So Amazon bills you per hour, so you have to make sure the assignment of number of cores is enough so that that complex code and that data volume is processed in multiple of hours. So within 1 hour or within 2 hours, because you will be charged for complete hour irrespective you use for 48 minutes or 98 minutes. You'll be charged for 60 minutes and 120 minutes. So that particular piece is really important. So we call that suppose B. So once you have A, that number of requests already open and active, and B is the new request, and A plus B should be less than the limit that has been defined for that AZ. If it is not, that means you don't have bandwidth, so go to the next AZ in the list because the list is sorted by the pricing. Once you run through all the list, suppose there are no AZ available for that instance type to have an EMR, we go to the next instance type, which is the higher one, and the cycle repeats. So there are so many checks done, like you run through almost 20 to 25 AZs and multiple instance types. We have never run into a case in last 1.5 years where we could not get an AZ or we could not get instance type to work for an EMR. So this is the flow diagram that we follow.
Is this an automated process or you have to use
it? No, this is an automated process. So imagine we have a dictionary defined, like list, not dictionary, sorry, list. So there is an instance type list for data set, which has M3X large, M32X large, M34X large. Exactly same thing happens. It picks up the first element of that list. It does the operation of identifying spot price across all AZs. Then for that AZ, how many instances I have already running, and on the right side, as for that particular data set, how many instances do I need for this instance type? So this whole flow is automated. There is no manual intervention. And everything has been working pretty well. So that's what I'm saying. We have not run into cases in last more than 1.5 years where we exhausted all AZs for a particular instance type. Or when we switched to next instance type, we could not get bandwidth for an EMR to work. Because the higher instance type you go, you need lower number of cores. So you will reach a state where you really need less number of cores for a heavy instance type, and you'll get that bandwidth. Suppose you don't get an instance type, you don't get an AZ, or code is smart enough to wait for an hour, because by that time, other EMRs will finish, so you'll create a bandwidth for this EMR to work. So that logic has been built in. So So what it resulted in, so what things we did was, first of all, we assigned the number of cores based on the data volume and the code complexity instead of keeping it static. So before, when we did the migration, we were more focused on doing the migration. So all the instance types, number of cores for a data set, everything was hard-coded. Even the AZ was hard-coded. We did not choose the cheapest AZ. So it used to create a static, like, line item of cost. But when we moved to this model, our cost graph also became like this. So this is actually production graph I pulled yesterday. I could not show the actual numbers, but these are like the real cost graph from directly from AWS. So if you see, 9.10 and 9.11 has the lowest cost because those were the weekends. Similarly, 9.17, 9.18, since we have lower volume of data over the weekend, we needed lower number of cores, and that translates to lower cost. You see a spike on 9.15 because that's when we did a restatement. And since there was a restatement, we needed more number of cores and the cost is higher on that day. So versus initially, the cost used to be static and it used to be on higher side. So we have saved a significant cost here as well by allocating the number of resources according to the demand and code complexity. The next thing I wanted to talk about was S3 as a data lake. So all our data is on S3, and instead of keeping the same data on database for load, we wanted to explore option where S3 can be used for data query, because ultimately the same restrictions apply to the database as well. The more data you need, The cluster size has to be bigger. That is an expensive solution. We are already paying for S3 storage because we have agreed as a team that we are not going to drop data from S3, which is really cheaper. So we can afford to have a longer storage on S3, but let's not keep the data for longer retention on database. So what we did was we created a dynamic persistent EMR cluster. By dynamic, I mean it goes up to X number of nodes during working hours, and it scales down to the minimum number of nodes which is required for any EMR to work during non-working hours or over the weekends. And to make sure that all the metadata is not within the cluster, because if you define your tables and your partitions in a cluster, when you lose the cluster, that information goes away. So we created a MySQL RDS to store all the Hive metadata, like what all tables are there, which S3 partition to read from, that resides in MySQL RDS. So Hive is usually slower. If you have used it, it uses MapReduce, and analysts are not big fan of it. They want something comparable to a database. So we installed Presto. It's an open source technology by Facebook. It's AnsiSQL compliant, and if you compare with Hive, it like blows away Hive completely. So Presto works very well with Parquet data format, which is the columnar storage. Since it is columnar, it is very fast versus a row-based model. So the architecture is like this. So the left side is all the production clusters putting data on S3. You have a Presto cluster along with Hive that reads data from S3, supported by Hive Metastore, which basically has all the tables and partitions. AWS Lambda is scaling the cluster up and down depending on the time of the day and day of the week. And it also takes care of restarting the cluster if it goes away. Suppose there was a bad hardware or something, if the cluster dies, within next 5 minutes, the cluster comes back. And nothing has to be done when the cluster comes back because there is no data on the cluster and there is no metadata on the cluster. So that is just serving as an interface to query the data which is already residing on S3. So the query options we have are Hue, which is for Hive. AirPal is the open source tool to query data using Presto that has been developed by Airbnb. And Tableau and other JDBC drivers are also available to query data from S3 using Presto. So once we started, we also thought that we might reach a stage where too many analysts are bumping onto this particular cluster and we are having the same issues of memory and all. So the good thing is you can create multiple clusters. So if I want to query the data for a week, I can create my own cluster because there is no data on cluster, there is no table definition defined. As soon as I create the cluster, all the data which is residing on S3 is readily available within an hour or within next few minutes for me to do my analysis. And as soon as I'm done, I can shut down the cluster. So you can have n number of clusters, there are no restrictions, and you can do your ad hoc analysis and all your queries using Presto, and the data is in S3. So the next thing was, how do we monitor so many clusters? There is no mature tool or service provided by EMR team like AWS, which focuses more on operations side. So what it used to do is it used to involve our ops team manually to restart those clusters, and also they had to monitor clusters across all regions. That used to impact our SLA. And few of the major reasons which can cause your EMRs to fail are either obviously for bad code or bad data that involves manual intervention, but something like your cluster was taken away because of spot pricing went up, or if you had network issues, like some hardware issues. So those things we knew, we don't need someone to manually intervene. So we created a utility called Prunella. It's a herb for self-healing. So what it does is, at a scheduled time, it collects all the EMRs that have failed in last 1 day. And it runs those cluster IDs against a DynamoDB table. And if it finds a new cluster ID, which is already not present, it makes an entry into that table. So AWS Lambda can work with different services. Like, for example, we saw a previous pipeline where it used to kick off when a file lands on S3. You can also make it work against DynamoDB. So as soon as a write or a record is written to DynamoDB table, it can kick off a Lambda function. It's a NoSQL offering from AWS. So as soon as the cluster ID is written to a DynamoDB table, it kicks off a Lambda function, which basically identifies what are the properties of that cluster, what is the data set, which country it was running for, what date it was running for, and then it drops a file for EMR to run, and then it goes back to that pipeline we discussed, that once a file is dropped to S3, it kicks off an EMR from Lambda. Additionally, we also send message to our operations team using Slack, and we notify them that, hey, this particular cluster has been restarted, and if the failure again happens again, we also notify them about that this has failed like X number of times. So after 5 or 6 that has been the agreement, then they have to manually get involved. Okay, something is really wrong. Either support has to be reached or something like that. So this utility, I think, has been running in production. We installed Q2, but we have not seen any issues where we had to reach out to support, and all the failed clusters literally have been restarted without any manual intervention. So this worked out pretty well. So to close my session, these are the few best practices and suggestions I'd like to mention. So try to tag everything. More you tag, more visibility you get into your resources, billing, and things like that. You can slice and dice your data more. Try to enforce lifecycle policies on S3 because your data bucket can literally grow if you don't pay attention, and it can result in bigger bills. Like, for example, our dev account had a separate credentials and separate buckets, and we realized that it was saving terabytes of data and we did not have lifecycle policies, and you don't need data for multiple years in your dev bucket. So try to set up lifecycle policies so that your objects expire after a particular retention period. Make use of spot instances, which are really cheaper options if it makes sense in your use case. Like I mentioned, for us, since it was a batch world, we could make use of it because we could survive with that provisioning time. But if you are using real time or something like that, I'm not sure whether that is a good fit. So depending on the use case, try to make use of that. Since we don't have persistent clusters in production, we try to make them keyless for security. So there is no key. No one can SSH into it. All our clusters are keyless. Apart from that, try to scale horizontally. So instead of adding more number of nodes to the same cluster when you have more workloads, try to create more number of clusters. Because 10 clusters running for 10 hours will cost you same as 10 clusters running in parallel for 1 hour. Ultimately, it's going to be 10 × 10, 100 hours of billing. So instead of having a cluster beefed up vertically, try to scale horizontally. Make use of loosely coupled applications. Try not to make a lot of dependencies within services as well. Like, for example, we don't write anything to DynamoDB from EMR. We write it to S3, and then it writes to DynamoDB. Because what will happen if you have any outages on DynamoDB, your EMR will be impacted. You don't want any process to be stuck if certain other services or certain data is not available. So EMR's operation is only to take the data, create the summaries, and put it on S3. Then from S3, if you want to load it to DynamoDB, Lambda, Redshift, then you can do after that. So try to create applications which are not too dependent on each other. So I think those are the major ones. Also, I wanted to announce that we are hiring as well. So if you know someone or if you're interested, please reach out to me. I think that's it. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer.